Started out as lying just to fit in. Over time the line came the life that I was living. I was always hiding my intentions, never understanding all that I was truly missing. But now I think I get it, got a better grip, I'm finally liking where I'm headed. Yeah, I think I finally have accepted myself for who I am. It feels the best when you're authentic.
Welcome to the Hip Hop Self Podcast, a place where we explore hip hop and what it means to be our authentic self. I am your host, Adam Sr. My guest today is Señor Gigio, a Bay Area hip hop artist, MC, singer, songwriter, cartoonist, and tarot reader. On today's episode, we will talk a lot about all those hats he wears, as well as his new album out now called The Life Aquatic. I am very excited to learn more about the man behind all these talents and exactly what goes into his creating such wonderful works of art. So without further ado, Señor Gigio, welcome to the show.
Peace. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Really happy to have you on. So the first question I like to ask everyone that comes on is just, when do you feel like your most authentic self?
Yeah, man. When I feel my most authentic self, it's usually when I'm just living in the moment and just not really thinking about the future or the past, just more or less like I'm in the moment, whatever it is. It could be a multitude of different things. Like if I'm in nature, if I'm going on a walk, or if I'm in, going on a hike, if I'm at the beach, or if I'm making some music. If I'm writing and just completely just in it, I'm performing, but it's just those sweet moments where we don't really control it, and there's no strings attached in those moments, and you just completely one just with everything,
Sure. I certainly feel that. Do you feel like you're consciously trying to create those moments, or does it kind of just happen for you in your life?
I think over time, I've had enough of those moments where I know how to go back to it, So I do try and have the space and time, in my daily routine to just allow that to happen, if it can, right? But I kind of know like the environment that I need for that to happen. So yeah, definitely I try to foster that in my life.
That's awesome. And do you meditate much?
I do. Yeah. Meditation is really key to just to me having any kind of sanity.
Yeah. What's your meditation practice? Do you have like a consistent one throughout the week, or how do you go about that?
Definitely. I have a very consistent meditation practice. And I've been practicing and exploring meditation for over 10 years, but really I would say like in the last 5 years, I started to have a little bit more discipline around it. Even like now, currently, like my relationship with meditation, it might not necessarily be like as disciplined. Like maybe at a certain point, I was like, okay, every day I'm going to wake up at this time and I'm going to put aside this amount of time to have that meditation. If it's like 30 minutes, sometimes an hour, and then also create that space before I go to bed, which I think is really crucial to just having a consistent, just setting a foundation for it. I think like doing something like that is really crucial. But now my relationship with meditation, although I could always use more discipline, it's just kind of more spur of the moment. But it happens throughout the day where I'm like, okay, I'm taking my little breaks in between things. If I'm putting on my dad hat, or if I'm putting on you know, my going out and doing my citizen of, you know, work hat, or doing my artist. I need to switch modes. I'll have a little meditation between those things, at least, just to kind of help me switch the energies.
Sure. And so now, in what you described as like being your authentic self, you said it kind of comes in those different moments in these states you're kind of talking about. So I'm kind of curious, what's the most recent moment you had like that?
That's a good question. You know, it's funny because it'll just happen, like it happens so randomly. I think maybe like a week or two ago, and I haven't, you know, this is one of the things too, like I live in the Bay Area, and you know, we have a lot of nature at our fingertips, and at the same time we have like the city urban life too, where, you know, sometimes we forget that, like, yo, nature is just like a 10-minute little drive to go to. And I hadn't really been to the ocean in a minute, so I was like, man, I just knew I needed it. So I went down to the ocean. I went down to the ocean and I just chilled on the rocks. And, you know, it's like, that's the thing, is like when you get to that space, you get down to the ocean, you sit down on the rocks and you put yourself there again, then it's like, oh, you want to start taking even more time just to stay there. You know, it's like you first on your way there, you're like, I'm just going to go for like 10 minutes or something but then you get there like, I'm starting to relax and I'm starting to get comfortable. So yeah, that was something that I did, like, I think that was like last week, and it was my first time going to the ocean in a minute, at least out here in the Bay.
Yeah. You know, I have you ever read the book, The Artist's Way?
No, I haven't.
It's definitely it's a very interesting read, but it's a book designed to kind of like unleash your kind of inner creativity even more so, and that's for anyone that's already a creative. But it's definitely geared maybe a little bit towards people that feel like they lost their sense of creativity. And it requires you to write these morning pages, but then also requires you to do at least something new at least once a week. And I always feel like those something news kind of creates those states you're talking about. Because it's like, you know, and I think even if it's like watching a show or, yeah, just like taking a walk somewhere new, that all just kind of like benefits us as people.
Yeah, switch up the routine. It'll be the littlest things too that can really help. Like sometimes I think that we, as people generally, I think a big, you know, part of humanity, the brain, we're perfectionists, you know, and that's how we're wired. So then when we start thinking about like what the change has to be, we keep imagining that it has to be this huge breakthrough thing. Like, no, it needs to be epic in order. And it's like, well, maybe you don't need to go climb Mount Everest. Maybe you just need to walk down a different street that you never walked down before, you know?
Exactly. Yeah. It can be as simple as that. It's the simple things in life that can be the most amazing, for sure. But you did mention you're from the Bay Area. Now, did you grow up there as well?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, you know, Northern California. I was born in San Francisco, and I was raised in a little suburb outside of some people. It's one of those little areas, like it's one of those towns that, like, depending on who you are, some people be like, no, that's the Bay, and some people be like, no, that's not the Bay. It's like one of those kinds of towns. But I always had a strong connection to the Bay Area because I was born in the city. Always had, you know, family and friends around, you know, Oakland, Vallejo. So I was always, you know, having that connection growing up. But essentially, like, Fairfield is kind of a slow place, and especially if you're like, you know, trying to make music, make art, do hip hop, it's just not the space where you got to be at. And it's like, well, Oakland, Berkeley, San Francisco, that's where it's at. So that's naturally where I gravitated to in my adult life.
Right. Yeah, the Bay Area certainly is given us a lot of great hip hop artists over the years. What does it mean to you to be from the Bay?
Oh man, it means so much. Like I'm just so grateful for everything. Cause yeah, even the hip hop, like of course, like I love the hip hop, but then I just love the overall history, like even extending back to like the 60s, you know, the counterculture movements that were popping off in the Bay, the hippie movement, you know, some of the revolutionary movements that were popping off, Haight-Ashbury, Nashbury, Telegraph. So yeah, it's always, at least for a long time, it had that aura. This is a place that that many people would go to find themselves pretty much and to find their new style. So many different artists came through to the Bay, you know, people like Robin Williams, Richard Pryor, you know, Richard Pryor before he was on his Bill Cosby kick, you know, kind of doing the more PG humor. He moved out to Oakland and that's where he was soaking up all the game from the Black Panthers. And then he comes back all radicalized, you know.
For sure. And so speaking of history, let's get into your history a little bit. I was doing some digging and I, you know, I first noticed, you know, your first album on Spotify was from 2018, but I was digging a little bit more and I came across, before you were Señor Gigio, it looked like you were just going by Gigio. Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And that I saw, something from, about 2008, which called Church Music.
Oh, wow.
And you know, I can tell like you've been spitting hard for years. And I was really loving the music now and the music back then. I can tell you really developed as an artist, like really, really well. And the one song I really loved, I watched a live performance of yours, was Like You Never Hear Me Before, I think it was called.
Yeah, Like Never Heard Me Before.
Yeah. Really loved that. So I kind of just want to get a sense of, hey, let's just start. When did you kind of first start rapping?
Well, I started exploring like rap and just like, you know, writing raps, recording raps when I was like kind of like 9, but it was more kind of goofy. It was kind of goofy just playing around. You know, my father always had computers growing up. So I think one day he brought home like a little tube mic and then just instantly I was like, yeah, I'm going to mess with that. But when I was, I think like 11 or 12, that's when the, when I really listened to like a full like rap album, like actually just listening to it, not just having it around, was the Nas album, I Am, that came out at the time. And, just from top to bottom, I listened to the whole thing and just like blew my mind, touched my heart, you know? And that's when I realized like, oh, like I can tell stories and I can affect people emotionally and that this is something that I want to do, you know? So then I started like trying to like actually develop like my writer's voice, you know, and other artists, I started listening like more intently to hip hop and actually listening to the albums versus just kind of, you know, we're kids, you know, we're not really like sitting there trying to learn so much. We just want to have fun. We're not trying to, you know, like listening to an album is kind of like reading a book, you know? So, but at the time there was Nas, there was Big Pun, Eminem, a lot of, you know, mainstream hip hop was still pretty good at that time. So yeah, and they were setting a bar for me that I was trying really hard to reach.
For sure.
Yeah.
So do you remember the first rap you wrote
at all? No, not at all. But I can tell you probably like the contents of some of what it was. I was just trying to write like little goofy storytelling stuff, you know, just reaching from the ethers, trying to make like a movie happen in my stuff, whatever it was, you know, trying to be dramatic.
Yeah. Well, I can tell from your content out now, like, yeah, you're definitely a storyteller and I love how conceptual your stuff is. So tell me about that process a little bit. When you are writing a song or working on a project, are you just kind of coming up with the story first and then just kind of making the songs to go along, or just, yeah, what's your process like there?
that's kind of how it happens. Usually like some it'll like be like an idea that gets into my head, and sometimes the idea I'm really like resonating with, like just from the jump, I'm like, ooh, yeah, that's freaking good. Like, I'm going to take that to the bank. I'm going to, you know, we're going to make that big, at least, you know, creatively in my brain, right? Like, there's a lot I can do with that. But then other times an idea will come to me and I'll be like, that's interesting, but nah. But then it just stays in my head. It's like, oh, okay, yeah, we're just going to see where this thing goes. And so, yeah, I tend to write very, you know, like if I'm making an album, it's usually like a concept album, you know, like exploring like an idea or a theme or a subject, or, you know, or maybe we're going into like a little world.
Yeah. Do you ever just kind of write to write and just like without concepts? Like, how's your freestyle game?
Oh man, my freestyle game is nice.
Is it?
Yeah, definitely. I'm pretty, and that's another thing though too. It's like, man, it's like I don't know how to put this all like in a resume, you know. But yeah, no, I'm my freestyle is nice. But it's actually it seems like I was just telling my wife the other day though too. Like when I'm by myself, like my freestyle game is weak. There's something about just other people being present. If they're rhyming with me, or if I just have an audience, it's just like all of a sudden I just like, you know what I mean? So yeah, my freestyle is very interactive, you know, but yeah, I got a nice freestyle game.
I'm the complete opposite when I'm alone.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's, I don't know if you, have you ever seen the movie Mystery Men?
Mm-mm.
It was a movie from, definitely like the early 90s. Ben Stiller was in it, and Kel from Keenan and Kel was in it.
Okay.
And he was the invisible boy or something, but he could only turn invisible if no one was watching.
Wow.
And I kind of feel like that's like me freestyling. Like, I can only freestyle well if no one's watching.
Mm-hmm. That's funny.
But let's get back into your story a bit. So you started though, again, as Gigio, and again, so what was kind of life like you for when you were Gigio, and how did that turn into Señor Gigio?
Definitely. I mean, you know, and this is one thing I really like about this idea of the hip hop self, because I love that idea of like, you know, using hip hop as a medium to find ourselves. And that's essentially what, hip hop has been for me. You know, it's not like going into this, I mean, I've always been passionate for it, and I've always in my heart hoped to make this my life, but so there's a lot of maturing to do, a lot of growing up to do, and not really a lot of mentorship or guidance, or like, you know, like there's not like really like a how-to book, there's not a college course, you know, for this. You just got to live it. So, you know, I've been through a lot of different stages, and I've definitely I was definitely a wild young man, you know, and just rapping, and that was just part of the lifestyle, you know, just having fun rapping and trying to be with my homies and whatever it was, trying to get shows, get drunk, get faded, chase some ladies, all of that. And then I just think there's just a certain gradual maturing process where I just kept growing and like getting, like, I guess kind of more serious the music kept getting for me, and the more opportunities kept coming from it. You know, I just naturally respond to that, and I keep looking at myself, keep finding myself, and I came to a point that I think, you know, I think also getting married kind of helped me find this in myself. I'm like, okay, I need to do things different, you know. I had made a lot of great strides and a lot of great connections, just, you know, doing my thing as Gigio, but I was just really ready to step it up a notch for myself and to really get serious about my craft and not half-ass anything, you know, not be amateur like in any one department, you know, like always come through and, you know, be just be professional, basically. And and then there's also just the fact that like Gigio is my name. So I wanted to make the distinction between like, you know, I'm Gigio all day, like whoever it is, like it's Gigio, but I'm like, well, when I do my art, I want to make the distinction for what that hat is that I'm wearing. And Señor fit perfectly into what I'm trying to represent, you know, just something a little bit more distinguished. It just holds me accountable is what it is.
Now, do you feel like there's Gigio and then there's Señor Gigio still kind of within you in terms of what you're talking about? And how do you handle like maybe that battle if there is one?
For sure. I mean, it is, you know, Gigio is my personal life, you know, and, you know, like these rap personas that we create for ourselves. I mean, I think that there's a lot of, you know, we always try to create the best image for ourselves to live up to, you know? So Señor Gigio, that's a high mark for Gigio to live up to. And I mostly do it, but, you know, I'm still maturing and I'm still growing. So yeah, Gigio, Gigio, you know, he's a good dude, great guy, but you know, he still doubts himself sometimes, or he's still, you know, cleaning up his act a little bit and learning how to be a man, you know, but Señor comes through he's on point.
Yeah. Now you mentioned doubt just there, and in your email, you know, you kind of said like, you know, it would be nice to kind of be in those authentic moments all the time. And then you mentioned like, but of course, you know, doubt, insecurity, anxiety, and stress comes into play. Do you not think those feelings are your authentic self?
They represent, I guess you, then we start looking at the shadow self, right? You know, we have our shadow self. So, you know, that's a part of me that's speaking to me still, like, hey, bro, like before you think you could just ride high or just like sweep this other shit to the side, like you got to look at this too, you know? So it comes up, those things, they come up not necessarily, to frighten us or to stagnate us or whatever it is, but really they make themselves, it makes itself present so that we can deal with it and just to, you know, keep us conscious, you know, that's what it's about. So,
yeah, I've been, you know, I certainly deal with all that. And I think for years I've been trying to avoid it, but it wasn't really till actually the pandemic this year that I just leaned into it. And I felt like, I was like, yeah, this is kind of just indicators that like I need to pay attention to myself a little bit more. You know, I think like those days that I just feel like kind of crippled with doubt or anxiety or kind of depression to me. And then when I take a step back and recharge and kind of just like, I'm definitely more of an introvert by nature. And I'm like, when I'm just like, okay, I need to go into introvert mode and then I can recharge. I find that only helps me my authentic self even more so. So I guess, is there a moment that you can look back on where maybe you had those negative emotions come up that really benefited you in some way?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I mean, especially when, you know, I've at least for the last like 6-7 years, like I've been trying to live more consciously, to hold myself more accountable, and to have a better relationship with myself. So yes, like end game is that I use all those moments to, you know, to turn it into something useful for myself, to have more information about myself and the world, and to just analyze it and to work through it. So definitely it's all character building. It's all life navigational, you know, tools.
Sure. And you also mentioned you are married. Congratulations. And I know you had a son recently. When did you guys meet?
Yeah. So that, we met, me and ZZ, that's my wife's name. We met like in, I believe 2013 we met. And, I had just moved back to San Francisco it was like my first weekend out. And this was like, this is also part of kind of like my, my little journey, of, you know, really holding myself accountable, like moving back to the city. I made this decision like, okay, I'm really going to show up and be serious and learn how to juggle having a job and paying rent and all that and not mess around this time and go 100% in on the music. And I literally met her my first weekend out, like my first week being there. There was a free hip hop event going down in the city. And she was vending, you know, she's also an artist and she makes pins from recycled magazines and different materials like that. And she was selling her pins that night. And I just looked across as soon as I walked in, I'm like, damn, who is that beautiful woman? You know, that's the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. I don't think there's no way this beautiful woman, you know, looks like a pinup doll, whatever. No way. But, you know, shot my shot, right? And I've known her since then. And we dated for a little bit. And then we were just friends for a long time. But, yep.
Awesome. So now I wanted to bring her up just because you did mention that also in the email that, you know, she's been helping you out, like with your videos and stuff. Now, has she been a part of your process creatively as well? Since Heroes of the Gold Rush, or was that more this album?
She's kind of been a part of the process for me since I put out this album in 2016. I Am Not My Name. But then even when we first met, because she intuitively could pick up on the fact that I could draw. And at the time, I wasn't really drawing or making art, but I always had that ability. And it was like one time that we hung out and it was never something that we talked about or, you know, anything that I was ever really putting out there. She just gave me a piece of paper and a pen and was like, draw, you know, and I drew something. And and then after that, she once we started like really, you know, like got engaged, it was her idea where she, out of her pens, you know, from her button business, she was making these little tiny canvases for me to draw on and do cartoons and stuff so that I could have merch to sell at my shows. So she also inspired that. And yeah, so in a way she was really encouraging me to bring my, you know, cartoonist skills into my music. And also I feel like that's also a distinction of me becoming Señor Gigio too, is like me putting the whole package together, me bringing my art into it. You know, every album I do is an artistic experience. And definitely when I was drawing the album cover, she really helped. She helped me color code it, basically. Like I would draw it and then she would kind of pick out the eye for what the colors would be. So she's definitely been like, you know, like a good partner in that sense. She's got a great eye for art.
Awesome. Yeah. That's obviously the first thing I noticed when looking at your stuff was the artwork, and it's awesome. Especially for, The Life Aquatic, but you know, even going back to Heroes of the Gold Rush, to me, it's like kind of saying, okay, like you're about to listen to something different, like right off the jump. And it is, it's very different. I definitely feel like I hear some E40 influence.
Yeah.
A little Too Short influence as well. And I feel like you made it your own way. You know, I definitely hear that Bay Area influence, and that it's like that old school Bay Area influence, which is really cool. And I think it's really fitting to the artwork. Like I do feel like those E40 Too Short, their styles, not necessarily the content and the lyrics, but their style was very playful, right? And it was almost kind of cartoony in a sense. So I feel like your animation fits your style very much so. Is that a conscious decision in terms of the artwork you're putting out? Like how does kind of your artwork you know, come to life in that sense in your head?
It's pretty crazy. Like, cause I've always, I've always been a visual person too. And I think that this was one of my struggles I was having before, like, you know, becoming Señor. Like, sometimes I would try to work with other artists, you know, like commission some artists, and I would have a hard time with them, like just trying to get people to commit or things like that. And, but I always, always knew what I wanted. Like, I could always see it in my brain, you know, like, this is what I want. This is what I need. And it just came to a point where I'm like, I'm going to draw this myself, you know, because I have like a vision for it. And then that practice of just first, you know, like that first initiative, taking that initiative of like, I'm going to take this vision I have in my head and put it on paper, and boom, here is the album cover. That's such a powerful just gateway into what will follow after. Like, you know, it wasn't necessarily like my intention to do all these other things afterward. I just was like, I need album art. Oh, right. And then after that, it's like, well, it just, the gateway is open. Now it's just a flood of everything. You know, we open the gates for so many more things. Like, when I did Heroes of the Gold Rush, first I had the album art done. Then I had a dream one night where I was told to make a comic book for it. So I made a comic book. And it was like my first comic book I did. And it released complimentary with the physical album at the time. So just things like that, you know, like just one thing after the next, you know?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. You mentioned earlier, like listening to an album is like reading a book. And that was like the first thing I noted when listening to your album. I did feel like it was a storybook almost come to life. And I just thought that was really cool. Like, I haven't really heard anything quite like that in that way. But so let's get into the album you have out now, The Life Aquatic. Tell me about kind of the development of that. I'm kind of curious for you, like, when did you know you had the album? Did the album idea come first and you were putting the songs to that? Or did you start writing a couple songs and you're like, okay, this is something. Let's make this Life Aquatic. Just from start to finish, kind of, how did it all work out for you?
Yeah. So this album, it was really inspired by working with the producer, Aquaman. And so he's based in Yosemite. And so basically, yeah, he had been like we have been running in like, you know, some of the same circles for a while, like, you know, doing shows together, networking. And, you know, I'd heard some stuff that he was producing for some friends of mine. I'm like, damn, this guy is really talented. And it's always been like my intention to just like really make some music, like not just do like hip hop and rap. And I just knew that he was just so talented that, you know, it was my intuition to work with him. And I reached out to him. I was like, dude, like, I'd love to make an album with you. And I just want to make like a real, like, eclectic album. And he was game. You know, we had talked about from the jump, the kind of sounds that we wanted to explore, some of the hyphy sounds, some dance music sounds, and soul music, R&B, and trap, and then also world music and pop, you know. And so that's really what it was. It was like, this album was really just about loving music. That's where it started, of just like, we love music, we want to make something that just shows how much we love music, to explore all these different, you know, things, and then use, of course, hip hop as the baseline to explore all these different sounds. And so we had all these different kind of like agreements of different sounds we wanted to do. And he was just making these great sound canvases, and certain things he was sending me, I'd be like, yeah, that's dope, let's add this to it, you know? And it was very organic. It was a complete like collaboration in that sense, you know? So yeah, it was just all about loving music. And over time, this one was, it was a more intuitive process, I guess, where it first, that idea of calling it the Life Aquatic came to me. I was like, okay, I don't know. It's just like, it keeps swishing around in my brain, the Life Aquatic, but it's like the movie, but I could keep seeing the artwork and all that for it. And, he was game. So we ran with that. And, yeah, but then it seemed like all these little song titles, like they were just kind of elemental, you know, things ended up being elemental, where we're exploring water, earth, weather, fire, all these different things, you know? So it kind of intuitively made itself.
For sure. And yeah, it is, for the people listening that haven't seen the album, it is spelled Life Aquatic, AWK, and which I love that spelling. Was that just to make it different than the movie, or was there something particularly about spelling it AWK that was purposeful?
Right. Well, that's my producer's name, right? Aquaman. He spells it AWKWA man. So it was it's a tribute to him.
I wasn't sure if it had anything to do with like any awkward moments.
I think he's kind of an awkward dude too. You know, he's a weird dude, but he's a great guy. You know, sweet dude. But.
Yeah, it's that leaning in to insecurity, yeah. Right? So
true.
But yeah, I mean, I love the production particularly. I think my favorite track that I just been humming along, like I was just like, what's that? I'm like, oh yeah, it's off this album. But one of my favorite was actually The Apple That Fell Far From the Tree. To me, I felt like that was a very personal kind of story about you. Is that true?
Yes, yes.
So tell me a little bit more about that song and kind of like what inspired that.
Yeah, man. So on one end, we knew that we wanted to make something that was exploring the Middle Eastern sounds and genre. And then and mixing that with, you know, kind of trap music. So he did his thing with that. And then then the idea of The Apple That Fell Far, it came to me like this is an authentic self moment. You know, I was going on a walk. And then, you know, who knows where these ideas come from, but it just kind of jumped into my head. And I was like, the apple that fell far from the tree. Yeah, you know, because that's what I am. And we think about the apple, usually when that saying, you know, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, you know, it's usually like attributing like a son to a father in a lot of cases, and a lot of times in a positive light. But I was thinking about what would it look like when the apple does fall far from the tree? Can that be a positive thing? You know? So yeah, and it is very personal because it is like my story, you know, it's like my life story coded with my family and all that. And yeah, I just wanted to put that into a little story. I think it's an important message for people to find because, I mean, we all don't have the opportunity to grow up in a family or an environment or neighborhood, whatever it is, that supports an individual to be themselves or to find themselves, you know? So it's really crucial to know how to navigate through that and to know that in itself is a special journey, you know, like it's not something to be ashamed of. It's something, you know, to be proud of and to be happy to have had that, you know? So I wanted to tell the story in a nice light and something that was digestible for anybody, you know?
Yeah, it definitely did. It definitely resonated with me in a lot of ways. And, you know, I was looking on your website and, there was a quote that you had on there. It said, "Life deemed impractical by society into a tangible physical reality." And I love that. And I feel like that's exactly what happens when an apple does fall far from a tree. Right? Mm-hmm. When it goes against kind of like the grain of society and the grain that your family tries to place on you. even if they're not conscious of it. But it's like, I think when you're choosing these creative fields, especially as a rapper today, particularly, you know, it's like a lot of people that aren't creative, that don't understand it, just seems like they kind of never will. And it's like, you got to take that journey to kind of make your own tree.
Yeah.
Can you kind of dive deep? Can you kind of maybe dive deep, if you want to, a little bit more into your story, of kind of like how you got to that point in yourself?
Sure. I mean, you know, the biggest distraction that we have here, or one of the biggest distractions that I think that we have, like, as individuals, is the world. You know, is the world, and I mean like the external world, you know, everything else, what everybody is trying to tell us. I mean, and that is important. You know, it's important to navigate the world and to have that, as a reflection of who we are, what we're doing, and what we're dealing with. But all too often, it's an easy distraction because people can just cling on to it without, you know, this is where the real work is, though. It's on the inside, you know, being able to go inside. And honestly, like, that is to me, the most noble pursuit that one could make, because ultimately you're going inside to be a better person for yourself. And it actually, in my experience, it makes the environment around you better. So, and that has a ripple effect into the world, you know, because that's generally what I believe. And at least what I feel like I know to be the problem of why there's so much disharmony in our planet today, is that people aren't living their own personal truth. They're living someone else's truth for them. They're carrying out someone else's will, you know, whether it's, you know, the government, whether it's, you know, their neighbor, their husband, their wife, their parents, their church, their temple, whatever it is, you know. But I feel, and that's what creates disharmony. That's what creates conflict in the human race, right? But if we all knew ourselves, then we would know our own personal place, you know, and we wouldn't have to feel challenged by others or to challenge others, because we would be ourselves living our full potential, you know. And it's a lot harder than it sounds, right? It's a lot harder than it seems, you know.
It is, and certainly certain people's circumstances, I think, can prevent that or make it kind of even harder for people to find that. So I do, like, definitely, I've been trying to acknowledge that privilege a little bit more, but it's like the more we can, I think, to spread that to others, I agree. I think the world would be a way better place, a way more empathetic place, because everyone's not focused on, like, what can people do for me, but what can I do for others? You know, because I'm at 100%, you know, there's that, like, that concept of, like, having a full cup to give to others. You know, and you can't give anything if your cup is empty. And I agree. I think I just wrote something the other day. I said, you know, we got to break off from our role to play our part, you know, and I think, like, we're kind of given this role starting out. And, I think particularly when we tap into creative moments that seem kind of magical at some points, we're like that, we're breaking away from the norm, you know, and I definitely feel that sense from you, which I think is amazing. So let's go just a little bit more with the album. I did see, just like, it seemed like the most played songs on the album I saw were Freedom Styley and King of Cups. So I loved the King of Cups video. I am curious, though, a little bit about Freedom Styley a little bit. I was looking at who you had feature on that. Isaiah Mostafa. Am I saying that correct?
Yes.
How did that happen? How did you guys link up? And, you know, what's the story behind that?
Sure. I love Isaiah. He's like my unofficial brother, you know, I mean, we like our connection is so strong. It feels like there's blood, you know, between us. But yeah, he's a young artist that I've met out here in the Bay Area. Like I've probably known him for like the last maybe like over 5 years, 6 years. Seen him maybe like when he was like a senior in high school performing, and he always had something about him. And just was always a pleasant young man. And I live in the East Bay, spent a lot of time in Berkeley. That's where he's from. And when I was reading tarot out there, he spent a lot of time out there, and our connection grew a lot stronger. And just, yeah, he blew my mind, more and more, like when I started, because we just like I knew he was an artist, obviously he knew I was an artist too, but we just were more or less just connecting as friends and as soul brothers, really. But when he put out his solo album, his first solo album called Lips, like 2 years ago, it blew me away. I was like, wow, like this dude is he's already like an amazing person. He has like one of those personalities where it's like, man, this guy is an angel. You know what I mean? Everybody loves this kid. He's so charismatic, you know, and a lot of fun. But then when I heard this album, I was like, dude, this kid is like one of the best artists I've ever heard. You know, and I'm a fan now. So, you know, I treated that opportunity, even with our connection being as close as we were, like I treated, you know, reaching out to him to collab like I would reaching out to any artist I really respect, you know, like with all the humility and everything. And so we recorded that song on, it was like the first week of shelter in place here in the Bay, and we were trying to make it happen. We were going to at first record it at his place. At the time he was staying with his grandmother, and she was like, no, this is not going down because of COVID. And I had access to an old church. And I was just like going through my brain, like, damn, we got this day already planned out together. Like, what are we going to do? And I was like, oh, what if we could get into this old church? So I got us access into this old church that's like no longer like in use. So we got in there. It was an old church. It was built like in the 1800s. And yeah, so all that reverb you hear in that song, it's all from natural reverb from the church. And yeah, we had a good time. We spent the day together, ate some food, grub, had a little adventure, and put the song together, you know, like that, you know. And so those are all those ideas floating around about, you know, freedom, you know, and being able to have adventure, and all those things came out.
Awesome. I love it. Yeah, it definitely, to me, like, it was a very standalone song to me, I felt like, on the album. And then also King of Cups, the video for that just seemed like you had a blast filming it. Tell me a little bit about the inspiration for that.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, the idea behind King of Cups, me and Aquaman, we wanted to make like some Motown music, you know, old school Motown, but of course beef it up hip hop style. And so yeah, then he made that beautiful beat, and I'm listening to it, and I'm like, wow, okay, that might have been the most challenging song that I've written and executed. But yeah, one of the inspirations, you know, like I said, like the Motown vibes, it's just like that whole idea. One of those things that I love from that era is that you have all these men, you know, masculine black men who are making these very sentimental, emotional, you know, vulnerable songs, pleading with their woman, saying, don't hurt me, baby, all that kind of stuff, you know. And I wanted to, you know, kind of tribute that style and the work, what they were doing, you know, from a man's perspective of being emotional, being in a relationship. So that was that part. And then the King of Cups layer is just from the tarot. There's that's one of the cards, is the King of Cups. And traditionally, the King of Cups is associated with water signs. I'm a Scorpio. That's a water sign. And, you know, we're emotional people. We hold everybody's emotions for them. You know, we're healing everybody else all the time. And then when it comes to us, people, you know, kind of take us to be like these very cool exterior people. But then when you see me break down and cry, don't be surprised, baby. You know what I mean?
Sure. And all the more reason we should all be a little bit brighter, so you're not soaking in so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. So, and just shooting the video, we just had, just wanted to bring all those water elements together. Got the attire, got my crown, got my cup, the water. We went and shot it in the Marin headlands. At least that scene there's four elements to the video. There's that element of me dressed as like the King of Cups, walking along the ocean side over there on the Marin headlands, with the cup. And then there's also the mermaid, who's played by Venus, my friend Venus Del Mar, really talented. She's a talented artist and a dancer. So she contributed some of that footage also, where she was, I can't remember where it was. It was like, where it's called, but it's a little like river up north in Grass Valley area. And, then my boy, Slide Master, we got him fitted in the Life Aquatic attire and went down to Modesto and just filmed him by a pool, you know, so you have that pool energy there. And then there's like some slight animation that I did in it too.
So that was your animation in there.
Yep.
So let's get into that. You also, cause you mentioned that animation is becoming a little bit more part of your life and something you might be doing more so in the future. Now is that, do you mean with your own stuff, or is kind of more opportunities coming to you as an animator?
Both. I just started animating cartoons, but it's for music videos, at least for now. Just this year, I did my first video for my song Wrong For That, where it's like a pretty much full length animation that I did, where I'm like, okay, let me just throw everything I got at it, because I already knew how to do it, but I knew the steps that I would take to do it. I just was procrastinating, you know, on actually doing it. But now it's kind of like, again, it's like once you do it that first time, then it's just like, boom, now the floodgates are open. Now we can do it again and again and do it better next time. Right. So, I've done a little bit since, little things that people have seen, but right now I'm really working on my first like full length commissioned music video for an artist. But I totally back it too. Like, it's not just about the commission. I support the artist's music, and I think I should be finishing this today. Actually, I'm like down to my last scene. Yeah, I've been working on it for like the last 2 months. So I think this will kind of give people a chance to really see like just how intense and crazy I can go.
Yeah. Now, can you mention who the artist is at all?
Sure. He's also a really crazy concept artist. His name is Nick Fuck, but he spells it N-I-K-F-U-Q. And, he's based out in Modesto, which is like the Central Valley area, California. He's super dope. He's like a concept artist, but a battle rap artist too. So it kind of like brings the battle rap style together with the concepts. And he really likes to Yeah, he gets into like, it's almost kind of like Jedi mind tricks, MF Doom. It's a little harder, you know, the stuff that he's touching. Obviously, right? His name is Nick Fuck, so it's a little harder. And that's also why I'm like stoked to do the video too, because I get to kind of explore like a different, you know, some of the more darker styles with the animation. But it's a lot of fun. It's all humor, you know?
Yeah, that's awesome. I love the idea of like kind of more animated hip hop videos, particularly, and giving people a different type of visual rather than just kind of your typical kind of music video today. You know, it's I think sometimes it is certainly great to have. I think it certainly helps more with promotion, but I do talk to a lot of people that are like, you watch music videos? I'm like, yeah, like you don't? Like, is that just not a thing anymore? It seems like more average people, unless you're really into music, don't really watch it as much. But I think having the animation element to it is really interesting. Where do you feel like maybe that's headed more so in the future? Like, do you think you would make more a whole album that's animated to kind of tell a story, like in your album cover style? What do you see more in the future for yourself?
Yeah, possibly could do that. I mean, it's very intensive work, you know. It can take a lot of time to do. I definitely want to continue to do it. And yeah, like if I did, I could see myself doing a whole album. Maybe that's possible. I definitely want to do another comic book for like the next project that I plan on putting out. I want to do another comic book for that. And yeah. And I just think it's, and I hope to connect, you know, to provide like this service for artists that I like. You know, I don't want to just like open it up to whoever, like, but I hope to connect this as a service to dope artists, you know, and just use it to continue building my brand too, you know. But yeah, right now it's like I'm still feeling it out, you know, still feeling it out. But I know that it's like one of those things, as soon as I get the next idea, the next inkling of what it is that I gotta do, then I'll do it, you know.
Yeah. And now, out of all the songs that you've written over the years, if someone came up to you and said, you know, who's Señor Gigio, what would be that song that you would play for them that you feel showcases you the most as an artist?
That's a really good question. I guess just out of, you know, my repertoire of what I have right now, I would say Wrong for That, just because it can show my, it kind of shows the variety of what I can do, like songwriting, you know, like there's some singing in it. There's some, you know, top notch lyricism. You know, I bring my best as an MC on it. And, yeah, I think it just shows like the mark of a good songwriter, you know, and storyteller on it.
All right. Yeah. So everyone definitely, check that out. I'll re-listen to that after this. But I feel like we covered well, just kind of your journey in music and the stuff you have out now. Do you feel like, is there anything you feel we've missed that you would want to talk about before we kind of move into the last segment here?
No, I think we covered a lot. Yeah. I feel good about it.
All right, cool. And so, yeah. So the last segment, is a segment I call the Authentic Shelf, which is just kind of anything, that we're bringing off kind of like a metaphorical shelf, you know, in our life that we've been authentically into throughout our whole lives, or just something we learned about recently, that you feel would be cool for others to check out. You know, you kind of mentioned to me what you wanted to talk about in the email. So I'm just kind of curious. Yeah. Like, what is it about that pick for you, that you feel would be cool for people to check out?
Right. Yeah. So I picked tarot, right? The tarot card. So I've been using tarot cards and reading tarot cards for myself and for others for like 5-6 years now. But so like what the tarot what it can offer people. It's just an exercise. It's an exercise. And because people think that it, like, it's all about the cards. That's the only time that magic happens, right? So one, it's like, if you're going to pick it up with an open mind, treat it, you know, pick it up like with the idea that, hey, this works. Let's just give it a try, and let's pretend that we believe in what's happening, and, you know, approach it with that mindset too, you know, because it's like, if you're going to go, it's about playing, right? We play, right? Like even when the inception of the cards, as far as history is a little mysterious, but what people do know about it is that when it started to kind of make its way back into like how we experience it today, was that people essentially were using it as playing cards. So it's just play, you know, play, right? Have fun. Same thing, like if you're going to play basketball, go play. Don't just say like, well, I'll never make the shot. Just go play, right? Have fun. So one, approach it with that, from that perspective, you know, with that intention. And then two, understand that the cards are not magic themselves, right? This is not just the one time that this happens. The cards just provide a time and a space where you can see what that feels like, you know, where you can say like, oh, let me just condense my entire life and how I experience consciousness into this one little moment right now. So the cards can act as a mirror in that way. You know, they can start getting you familiar with that kind of rhythm and that kind of communication that can come through messages, all that kind of stuff, numbers, pictures, you know, synchronicities. Then once you put the cards away, you can start seeing how just on your everyday walk, on your everyday life, how there is an intelligence to, you know, what we're experiencing. And there is something that is more or less trying to guide us. There is a force in our personal lives that is more or less trying to guide us along the right path, you know, but it's just about being conscious and aware to that energy, you know? So that energy is going to look different from person to person, how that person experiences it. You know, it, like I said, one person, it could be that they're picking it up through numbers. Another person can be picking it up through symbols. Another person can be picking it up through auditory, just by like, wait, like I walked past this couple and they just happened to have a conversation about something that I was talking about, or something that I've been thinking about that I want to get, you know, it's stuff like that. So the cards just provide a exercise space to start familiarizing yourself with that kind of energy, basically.
So I almost get the sense of it, which I'm still kind of learning this myself. I just started talking to Moon Magic a little bit more about tarot, which you were on her show, which I watched, which was awesome. And she's been kind of trying to school me a little bit. But I'm very new at it, but it kind of, like, from what you described, it's kind of like the cards are almost here in our, always in our whole lives. So it's like, even if we're not picking a card, it's kind of like we could kind of pick a card from the world if we're really paying attention, and the cards are kind of just channeling that energy that we should already be paying attention to. Is that about right?
Totally. I mean, and again, it's you know, some people, or a lot of people in our world today, there's a lot of fear around using these kinds of tools, because there's been a lot of misinformation and things like that put out there about it. But it's like, no, understand that there is a natural rhythm, that there is a natural source to this energy and to understanding it, you know, like that we don't have to cut ourselves off from, you know, it's all, nothing is going to hurt you. You know, unless that's what you want to create, but that's not the source of your life. you know, like life itself, you know, life itself is living, you know, so the source of life itself is living. It wants you to live. It wants it to be lived to its fullest potential because, again, life is given to us. And then how do we live life? By being in the present. The present is a gift, right? So it wants us to live it, you know, and it wants us to live it fully, you know, doesn't want us to take it for granted.
For sure. Do you find the people that are kind of afraid of it are like, do you feel like it's a certain type of person? Is it someone that maybe isn't as creative, that is kind of operating in these like roles that society wants us to play?
Sure. I mean, it's that. And then it's also people who are afraid to look at themselves, you know, people who are afraid to hold themselves accountable, people who want to believe that the actions that they are making, the decisions that they're making in life have no consequence. You know, they don't want to believe that their actions are hurting another, you know, or are hurting themselves. You know, they just want to, some people have a certain mind state, because really that's kind of what the indoctrination is that there's no point to anything and we're just here because, and we're animals and, you know, whatever, we're animals and we all die. And hey, unless you can prove it, you know, I'm just going to continue not giving a shit and hurting people. Those are the kind of people that they don't want to see. They don't want to see what the real cause of and effect of what they're doing is.
Yeah. And I do like that you said it. It's like play, almost like childlike play. Cause I do think it's like those type of people, I think, lose that sense of their self, of like what we used to do as children, you know? And it's like, who would, if you were a kid and someone's like, hey, I want to play this card game, what kid's going to be like, no, like I'm afraid of that. Like, it's like, no, like most kids are curious and kind of want to play, you know? And I think it's like, it's important to have that, especially as adults. I think that only makes things, like, makes life better.
Right. And it's even the tarot is what brought forth poker. So, you know, if you're playing poker, you play poker, you know, whatever it is, right? That's an offset of tarot. So those cards, you can read the poker cards the same way. That's why, you know, Kenny Rogers, he's saying you got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them. is he talking about the game, about gambling, or is he talking about life?
you know, I'd say both, right? Like in a sense.
Right. It goes both ways. So that's why those good card players, they're actually really good at reading life energies, you know, because that's the thing. It's like the thing about, you know, like when I'm reading the cards for myself or for others, it's not about you're ever just doomed. Nobody's ever doomed. It's always constructive. It's always going to show you what your weak points are, but then it's always going to show you what your strong points are, and your strong suit is the truth, you know?
Yeah. And you are you do tarot readings as well, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So how do people reach out to you to do that?
Well, I have it set up through my website too, so you could book with me through there, but just reaching out, just DMing me, you know, works too. Just saying, hey, what's up? And I'm open to any questions people might have about it too.
Well, I definitely think I might try to do that with you at some point. So definitely look forward to that in the future. But I like to also just provide a pick off my authentic shelf as well for the people listening. And, you know, in looking at your catalog and kind of seeing who you are as a person and looking at your influence, I just kept coming back to E40. And the first movie that ever introduced me to E40 really was the movie Stomp the Yard. Have you ever seen that movie?
Man, I don't think I have. Does it play his song in it, or is he in it?
Yeah, so it was Go Hard. I think it was Go Hard or Go Home. Go Hard or Go Home.
Yeah.
So that was like the first song. I was like, what is this song? And I was like, I never really got into like a lot of, I grew up mainly listening to like Kanye, Common, a lot of like the Chicago kind of more East Coast stuff. I did not really tap into like the Too Short E40 seen that much. You definitely inspired me to look more into that. I always thought the flow was just a little bit like I was not used to it, you know, so I wasn't as comfortable listening to it, but you definitely inspired me to want to explore that a little bit more.
Right on. I love E40. He's definitely an influence. And we actually share the same birthday too.
Awesome. I'm so glad that I brought that up. But yeah, Stomp, but the actual pick isn't E40, but it is the movie Stomp the Yard, which is probably like one of my favorite movies like of all time, which is weird. I doubt it got a good Rotten Tomatoes score. But Chris Brown's in it, Columbus Short, and Megan Good, who is definitely one of my crushes growing up. But it's a great kind of just flick about just like dancing, and like if you love music, it has a ton of good music in it. And you know, I just remember being in college, I wanted to like dance like that so much, so like my roommates would leave and I would just like put on Stomp the Yard and like, you know, just like try to dance to the film. So if no one has ever seen that movie, I highly suggest watching it, especially if you like dancing in E40. But yeah, definitely recommend you watching that if you haven't seen it as well. Would maybe be a good one to watch with the wife.
Yeah, definitely. That sounds cool.
But before I let you go, any last words of wisdom you would like to give the people listening?
I guess just tell everybody, like, there's so much power in what we project, you know, what we unconsciously project, you know, and the end game is not written yet, you know. A lot of people are defeatist, you know, defeatist about the world, about whatever it is that we're doing in life. The end game is not determined. So let's be creative and let's be conscious about the kind of world that we're creating for ourselves, for our community, for our loved ones, for the children coming up. Let's speak the good into existence. And you know, right now I know obviously it's been a really challenging time for a lot of people with the pandemic and whatnot. But it's a great time to be creative, like you were saying, you know, and really that's what it's about. Just be creative. You use your God-given talent to, just get that energy out, you know, and see what it brings to you. Because it's like the same thing where the creative process of whatever it is, if you're a gardener, painter, musician, writer, whatever it is, even if you're entrepreneur and you're just ready to get your little business off the ground, it's a small little practice for something much bigger. You know, like if I can create this little thing for myself, then I could create a better world too. You know, there's the microcosmic level, which is the internal world, but then on the macrocosmic level, we're creating something in the world, we're creating a change. So it's a great time to be creative, great time to you know, if certain things are causing dissonance in our body, in our psyche, it's a great time to explore those things and to come up with solutions for them. You know, the future is bright if we want it to be.
Yeah. Yeah. If you're feeling lost like that, you know, maybe just hit up Senior Gigio, get those tarot readings done, and that's going to be all you need. But but that's great. I love that. And where can the people follow you, listen to your music, and just see all the amazing work you've been doing?
Sure. So Señor Gigio on Instagram. Instagram seems to be like my best little space on there. So with social media, I'm on Twitter as well. Facebook, look up Señor Gigio on YouTube. And also check out my website, www.señorgigio.guru.
Awesome. Well, I can't wait to hear more stuff you put out in the future. And everybody definitely follow that, listen to The Life Aquatic, and check out all of his cartoon work and animation. And you know, just definitely follow this guy. You know, I definitely love everything you're doing. And it was just an absolute pleasure having you on today.
Thank you, bro. I appreciate that. My pleasure to connect with you too. I appreciate, you know, what you're doing and, you know, the platform you're creating and the content you're putting out there and how you're relating it to hip hop and just being a better person.
Thank you. Appreciate that. But peace, love, and happiness to you and your family.
Thank you, bro. You too.
Yeah, be well.